So I'm here with Guillermo, and for this video, I would like to go through a concrete example of serverless and how it would look like for a concrete example for a developer. We talked about different topics, and I want to have all the topics in an example. So imagine I have an application or a website, okay? Let's say a marketing website. Obviously, it should be fast, care about SEO, all these kind of things. And, you know, I would like to deploy it on serverless. How would that look like concretely?
Yeah, so typically we integrate with any framework that already exists, whether it's Vue, React. We support and created Next.js. So with Next.js, typically you start by creating a pages directory. And inside that pages directory, you sort of define all your customer-facing entry points into your application, whether it's marketing pages or login pages. So you could have about.js for your about page, or you could have login.js for your login. So the interesting thing is when you deploy it with serverless, what we have you do is say, hey, I want to use Next.js. So we don't really lock you into a particular framework. And what our platform will do is it'll take the pages directory and it'll turn each one of those into an independent serverless function. But you don't really change the way that you've been writing your application. And alongside your Next.js code, for example, you can define API endpoints. You can define static pages. So it's this idea of what we call the majestic monorepo. It's a monorepo that can contain all your customer-facing logic for serverless functions, as well as assets and static files, as well as APIs. And the monorepo has this amazing advantage that you always deploy everything at once. And because serverless makes deployment so fast, you don't really need to go around and split up your code into 100 million places. You always just run now and you get your URL back, or you get push and we give you a URL for your deployment.
But does it change anything if I have to call, for instance, I don't know, some API for getting the content into the onto the website?
No, it's just as static or dynamic as you want. And the really cool thing is that we sort of deploy this to a CDN layer. So if you have static data, we can automatically cache it. Mm-hmm. If you have something that's more dynamic, you can serve it on demand and you can server render for each request. Or you can also piggyback on what we call the cache control API. So you can respond with HTTP headers to cache your content at the edge.
Right. So, but still this monorepo thing is that you have all the logic different. Even if you have endpoints, it will be in the same repo. You will not.
Yeah, it's great. And a great example of why this is useful is companies love to have design systems or style guides. Mm-hmm. So you kind of want to have a coherent set of components for the entire company. And companies don't tend to have only one project that is, you know, like, oh, you log in here and this is the entirety of my company. They tend to want to split up their logic and their teams into sections, sometimes into different technologies. But at the end of the day, when it comes to the customer, you want to see the components and the styles all look the same. So the monorepo allows you to have components that could be shared between many different pages. Sometimes even, for example, you could have validation rules or TypeScript types that are shared between the API and the client side. And you can have all of that always in synchrony. You don't worry about synchronization because it's all in the monorepo.
Now there will be people that will tell you, are you talking about monoliths project? It's dangerous.
That's why I always make the distinction between monorepo and monolith. I think monolith you probably don't want because monoliths just grow infinitely in size. And as we talked about, like without any limit in size, you will become slow. Sooner or later, you're going to become slow. But with monorepos, remember that we're compiling your code
into
discrete functions and outputs, which means it can sort of scale endlessly.
So the property that differentiates between a monolith application and a monorepo is the fact that functions are independent.
Yeah. So monolith means you're developing a gigantic server. And then typically when people deploy it, it becomes a gigantic container. So there is no way around it. But I think, this is my take, obviously, I think people like monoliths because if you're doing a monolith, you're always doing a monorepo. So what we're saying is we like the monorepo property. We like that you have one deployment strategy, one command. We like that you get push and it deploys automatically and you don't have to synchronize many repos, et cetera. But what we don't like is monoliths take forever to instantiate. They're very expensive to run. You typically have to write health checks and monitoring rules. They just become slow over time.
Right. Okay, thank you very much, Guillermo, for these videos.
Thank you.